I thank the organizers for inviting me. It is a great pleasure to speak in this conference in honor of Iluzi. I knew Iluzi for a long time since I came to the IHES in the early 80s. And before this, I knew about his work. When I was a student at Harvard, I wanted to learn about fancy things, and Mumford suggested to me to look at Iluzi's thesis. And during my summertime in Israel, I tried to read those lecture notes, and I could read the first volume, and the second one, I read just the beginning. It was too technical to make progress, and no one else took it from the library. So this was very helpful for further work. In fact, in my work, for example, in my work on Faltings Almost Mathematics with Romero, I used the cotangent complex to improve my several important things on. And so in the previous conference in honor of Iluzi in 2005, I lectured on finiteness theorems for non-abelian H1, and later in the Linz conference on finiteness theorem for Rital cohomology for quasi-excellent schemes. And this was the subject of a group de travail organized by Iluzi, and then he was an editor of the volume describing the result. And so what I will speak about now is related to this subject. So in fact, Iluzi wrote in 2006 a manuscript called Vanishing Cycles Over General Bases after the Lin, let me see, anyway, after the Lin or Blomon or Gogos or Gabber. So I will speak about the question that he asked in the end of this paper. And so this is, in fact, a subject I already spoke about in Tokyo in 2007 and 2008 and 2009. And then in 2018, I gave another lecture in Tokyo about things, other results on vanishing cycles on the general basis. And this also led to some results I spoke about in Oberwolfach last year. So now I will reconstruct the first lecture, so the one about the question of Iluzi. So so this will be about a comparison of oriented products. So this already appeared in the talk of Abbes and the rigid et al. And in fact, this, so there is so in the case where I have a subscheme of a scheme X, let us say defined locally by finite type ideal, there is a map . So there is some kind of, something that Fujiwara denotes as a tubular neighborhood topos. So this is you take the formal completion kind of minus y, which doesn't exist, but it exists as some kind of adic space or Renault types rigid space. And then you take the tal topos of this. So there is a comparison map, which also occurred more recently in some lectures in the seminar of algebraic geometry of Orsay. And the result was that in the quasi-excellent case, for a constructible shift, torsion constructible shift, torsion prime to the residue characteristic, the natural map is an isomorphism And this is a kind of a version of a comparison between algebraic and rigid analytic talc homology. So in any case, so we so the oriented product is a solution of a two universal problem. So you want toposes with maps T to TI, T to T1, T to T2, so that the composition on the composition you have a map like this. And the definition of the two category of maps between the definition of the two category of toposes is like in SGA4, in particular the points. There is a notion of specialization of points, so that the amorphism between amorphism between points is a morphism of the corresponding fiber functors in the opposite direction. There is a defining site for the oriented product, assuming that you have defining sites for the TI, where let us say I consider only sites with finite projective limits, and the morphisms are compatible with the limits to simplify. At least it is used in some references. And then the coverings, like in the previous talk, you consider U U over F inverse W V over G. So you have coverings of the form, coverings in U, coverings in V, and then like in the previous talk for any morphism for the same as in the so this is the asymmetric part where you you assume that this is so if you do it on both sides, you get a site that defines the fibered product of toposes, not the oriented product. What?
You have the map from the above, from U to V.
You change notation, you switch it.
No, so I don't remember.
You need a map. You have the three things and the map. So one of the three things is both of you as the original thing. So you need a map from U to D, I think.
No, here I have sites. So I have sites. There is a site for T1, site for T3, site for T2. And then there are morphisms of sites which are functors preserving finite limits. And then I have a map from U. Well, I write it. I have a map from U to what I call F inverse of W, from V to. So this is like U over W and V over W.
Well, I mean the upper object is U to V and D.
So here I have
U to V. So this is just type C.
Yes, so type C. Then you have some kind of localization, so it's like a section of it have neighborhood, so U to V.
I think you have in any case, this is a standard. I just recall what was already.
Both triples, the first term is U.
Yeah, both triples, the first term is U, and this changes by a pullback. Okay, so this In any case, so if both are, so this was yeah, so this was something introduced by Deligne to, and then studied by Lomon to define vanishing cycle of a general basis using this canonical map. I need some properties of this relative to change. So for example, in the visage arguments, so if y prime to y, let us say, so this is exchange in the first so actually this is an equivalence if this is, let us say, integral, so it's like finite. And so this is an equivalence for a tal. And if instead it is proper, then it is not, but you can still prove that, at least for torsion, that it doesn't change the cohomology of sheaves. So, now, those toposes are coherent, but they also have the property. So if I have, let us say, a coherent topos, I can look at the so-called localic reflection, or so I want to like map it to a topological space, or a topos that comes from a topological space. So I use the sub-object of the final object. And here it becomes a spectral space, which, and then every point of this can be lifted to a point of x. This is a small extension of Deligne's theorem. And then I have a special type of toposes, or let's call them type A coherent toposes, where for every point of the corresponding topological space, the corresponding fibered product topos is equivalent to representations of some, to G sets, so the topos of G sets, where G is a profinite group. So for example, a tal topoi of schemes or of adic spaces are like this, and also this is stable under this construction where all morphisms are coherent. And in fact, you can do this construction also when one morph, well, there is small generalization where one morphism is not coherent, but, so one important thing is a base change, or in fact, a universal base change result, which is like what Abbes was speaking about. So in fact, I wrote an email to Elouzi, I think in 2006, discussing such things. So we have a general situation. So we recall that I have in any case, so there is this general construction that Abbes called the co-vanishing. So in any case, suppose that I have a fibered site where the fibers are sites with a finite limit and finite covering families, and you have a base which is a topology, and you considered on the total space the horizontal and vertical covering families and the corresponding topos. And in this case, it maps to the topos downstairs. And if S is coherent, that this is coherent, in general, it doesn't have to be coherent, but the direct, higher direct images are computed by sheafifying on the level of pre-sheaves, the cohomology of the fibers. And moreover, it has the property that for any map of toposes, the corresponding fibered product topos, can be described in the same way. And actually, there is a kind of universal, kind of formal type of universal base change theorem. So we can say that the map of toposes satisfying universal base change theorem, if for any you can give two toposes over T and you consider the corresponding fibered product, and you want that, let's say, for a shift of a billion groups, that you have a corresponding base change map, like in the proper base change theorem, are isomorphism, similarly for shift of sets, shift of groups. So this kind of situation satisfies a universal base change theorem. And the construction of the of the oriented product is a special case of this construction.
Can you recall the horizontal and vertical morphism covering?
So I have a pseudo functor from the category S to sites. I mean to, and then I if I have a covering family here, and I pull it back by a Cartesian thing, and I have a covering family in the on the fiber. So at least so this can be defined quite generally. I mean, you can also relax some hypotheses like this finite limit, but this I don't, I mean, it can become technical. In any case, you can, the point is once you assume that the covering families are finite, you can control shiftification by just shiftifying, it is done in this paper of Abbes and Go, and also I wrote to you an email and the universal base change theorem is kind of just looking at this and seeing that you can, since you know how to describe, by choosing suitable defining side, you know how to describe the
it was in your email of 15 years ago.
Yes,
and
yes.
I forgot.
Yes, in any case, as a sketch at least. So in any case, the these toposes where I have this, in this situation, I have the, one can define the notion of constructibility for shift of sets and shift of groups, and the correspond, and I mean, the usual conditions are equivalent, like there is a stratification which is locally constant, or is a finitely presented object categorically, and so it's a, and so how do I get another? So in any case, the so one can consider also morphisms between, so first of all, there is a notion of constructible shift, let us say with coefficients in a finite ring. And then you can also look at Noetherianity. So in the case of local Noetherian schemes, any ascending sequence of subshift of a constructible shift is stationary. So something similar is true here. So for example, if y is Noetherian and x1 and x2, let us say, a finite type over y, then this is not, is also Noetherian topos coherent of type A, which means that any quasi-compact object is also Noetherian. And this is reduced to Noetherianity, local Noetherianity of the underlying topological space. So here one maps to the corresponding fibered product space. So there is a localic reflection which maps to this, and subjectively, and so you have to look at the map. Any point here is actually lifts. There are finitely many lifting, and you need some generic generalization property. So there is a criterion giving Noetherianity of the corresponding space, which is slightly stronger than the fibers being finite in this space being Noetherian. So using this, the basic points are given by geometric points, so x1, x2, and a point such that and the morphism between white, the images in Y. Excuse me, this is again. The for any such point, the corresponding automorphism group of like Galois group is contained in the Galois groups, the product of the Galois group. The idea is to reduce statement on sheaves to statements of sheaves of particular kind, like sheaves of the form tensor product of sheaves on each factor. Tensor product of sheaves coming, let's say, Z mod L sheaves coming from each factor. And this can be done, so one can prove that the if I consider such sheaves and you consider the subcategory which is closed under extensions and direct summons and isomorphisms, the smallest one containing this, then you get all constructible sheaves, let's say Z mod L sheaves, on the oriented product. So I can reduce the, for certain cohomological statements to such things. And so, yes, I want to speak about the rigid analytic. I have to use the middle one, or
whatever you want.
Or the tubular neighborhood. So Fujiwara denoted by TF over Y, but this is also the tal topos of the adic space. So I have, let us say, Y in X, let us say, they're quasi-compact and quasi-separated. Y is defined by a finite type ideal. Then I have the formal completion. So I want to view this as a rigid analytic space and take the corresponding tal topos. So first, let us consider the usual rigid, the usual topology, which gives you the Zariski-Riemann space. So you have the blow-ups of relative admissible blow-ups to. So you have the inverse limit, and I have chi. Let's say this chi, and let us have the part over y. Then I can, so of course there is some foundational issue in defining the, in the non-Noetherian case, but at least one can define an algebraic version of the, well, it is in Fujiwara's paper, but one can define a kind of Enzelian version of the rigid etal. So let us consider the following site. I have x prime to x, which is of finite type, and etal outside y, and the coverings are those families such that the corresponding Zariski-Riemann space, so this chi relative to y, to the Do you have surjectivity on the corresponding Zariski-Riemann level? So in fact, you can, so think about it, like after you blow up everything, you get a situation, essentially you have evaluative rings, and then you can also consider the tal topology of the special fiber. And then you have to take, like in previous, you have to take some, what remains is just a finite tal cover of the general fiber. So in fact, this can be described like in the previous talk as a kind of Faltings topos. So I have the yeah, so I have the let us take on the limit space, I have the tal topology. So I can consider O chi. So let us say O chi is locally, you invert something. And so you can consider U going to finite tal O chi bar O U 1 over phi. Algebras like in the previous talk, but you restrict it to just to the to chi bar. So you have well, this is a kind of a fiber site over chi, but you have to pull it back to chi bar. So at every point of chi bar, you get in the limit, you get what, like in the previous talk, the corresponding thing for the stock. So the idea, the point is that the co-vanishing or the horizontal vertical topos for this, one can see that this is equivalent to the rigid tal topos. And in particular, one has some kind of universal bend change property. It can be used to give variants of some proofs in Huber's book. But so this is for analytic adic spaces. So just to yeah, so so in any case, the so this rigid analytic topos has a map to the tal topos of x minus y. It's like a Gaga morphism. This is a non-coherent map between coherent toposes. And it has also a map to y. And then there is an arrow like this. So this means that for an tal x minus y scheme, you can define the corresponding sheaf. So this comes by just evaluating it on this and the sheaf. On such things. And so this gives a map from this to the oriented product of a tal topoi, which is, so here I have coherent maps to, this is a non-coherent map in general. And then I want to prove a comparison theorem for epsilon. So for constructible sheafs, I want to prove that this is an isomorphism. So So roughly there are the visage processes where I can restrict to sheaves which come from the factors. And then using behavior for finite or proper maps. And I also need my weak local uniformization theorem, which was used in the asterisk book. So at least so you reduce to you reduce to the case where the sheaf on F on this is, let us say, reduced to F2 to be extension so I have to evaluate this on some object. So actually, I have let us say I have to evaluate on an object of this site, but I will reduce. So essentially, the main point is to reduce to cohomology on things of the form this, where V is open in X minus Y, and using the structure of sheaf and the visage, I reduce to sheaves coming from Y. So
this isomorphism implies the computation of vanishing cycles, like, so we know that if you compute vanishing cycles like this, or if you pull back and push forward, you get the same thing. But your isomorphism there, I think it implies this, no? Is that it? The isomorphism you wrote?
Yeah, this is under a strong condition of quasi-excellence. Quasi-excellence and constructibility. Yeah. And what you're speaking about is...
it's just for torsion.
You mean that...
on the diagram above, if you exactly you start from there, you can take the vanishing cycles, the naive vanishing cycles, means higher direct image pullback, and you can also take the pullback and higher direct image, and we know this is an isomorphism for torsion.
Yeah, okay, this comparison is the kind of an easy comparison. Here it is a comparison for a kind of open non-quasi-compact domain in the rigid space, like the comparison on affinoid minus F equals zero. What you're saying is that comparison on affinoid. So of course, the point is that all the previous things would enter into steps in the proofs. So I will not, but essentially, the so I am, so, so, as so maybe my notation was omega before. So the idea is that I have omega to x. So I have some direct images of, let us say, Z mod L from just in the scheme theoretic sense restricted to Y. And I want to compare it to the rigid analytic direct images. So going to going to Y. So I want to, of course. So this is a non-quasi-compact map, And when omega is everything, you get the previous comparison result. So the idea is to reduce, in any case, using weak local uniform. And also I have a twist by some shift on y. So the idea is that using a certain universal base, so omega will be exhausted by domains in some canonical using certain blow-up by some omega I by quasi-coupon, quasi-separated thing. So essentially we will prove that for a large enough index, I have comparison in the quasi-excellent case. And the twist by shift on y will be handled using a universal band change theorem. So, so essentially it reduces to calculation in the constant case. Now in the constant case, I will reduce to things which come from logarithmic geometry. So, so let us say you have, suppose you have log regular, and this is, let us say, u is x minus some union of strata, and let us say you have an affine open immersion. Actually, well, then one can prove that it is principal, so locally it is given by, so u is like locally x1 minus phi, and then there is a purity, absolute cohomological purity, which implies a statement in log regular case, and for the inclusion of the strata where the log structure is trivial, but you can generalize it to such things. So you have that R J log star, let us say Z mod N is wedge I of R1, and R1 comes from the Kummer sequence. So you have J O U star over O star with a Tay twist tensor Z mod N. So one can check this, and then
I will reduce
the calculation. So I have my omega. Let us say, so I have my y, x, let us say, and then maybe bigger one is z. So omega is the complement of x minus z.
So sorry, R I J lower star, I mean, I was in immersion, right?
Yes. No, R, let us call it J, for example. So,
omega is an open of what?
Okay. So, suppose that I have, so this is defined by an ideal I, and this is defined by an ideal J. And then I can construct the blow up of J plus I to the N X. And the open where I to the N generates. So this, so you can think about the case where, let us say, those are principal ideals, let us say F and phi. So you want to consider the domain, like the rigid analytic domain where the absolute value of F is at least phi to the N. This is obtained by certain blow up. So essentially add F phi to the N. So, and then, so I have my kind of omega n in the rigid, which has a nice model using this. So the idea is to take this. So in the I reduce to the log regular or the normal crossing situation. But in any case, then I will need to make some. So at least I will have, after normalized blow up, I will have a log regular situation. And I blow up some idea like F5 to two elements. So the point is that I will have a locus where when I look at this experiment normalized to X and restrict to Y. So there will be points where, at least when N is large, the fiber of the blow up, at least the full blow up, is a P1 and the affine part is A1, or just the origin when I don't, like when the. So I will have a closed locus where the blow up gives A1 in the fibers, and this will be independent of N. And then when I normalize, I just add some possibly some roots. So on the reduced, the point is on the reduced fiber, on the reduced locus, there will be still an action of GM, at least after some cover. So all the sheaves that I get from like X minus Z going to X prime N. So all the direct image shifts that I get on the will be calculated using this. And so there will be a constructible. So in fact, the relative to the GM action, there will be monodromic in the sense over DA. And then one knows that the cohomology on the kind of the special fiber that is over Y can be computed just by restricting to the zero section. So, and then when I look at this calculation, one can compare the zero section, I mean, see that this also gives a direct image from X minus Z to X. So one can compare the two computations and see that you have a comparison for large N. So this actually will be, so I will prove the statement in the strong form that that for large N, so omega N ridge to Y, so for large N, RF low star of CZ mod N is RI is isomorphic to RI FN, well, Z mod L. So at least, so for a given degree of cohomology, since I use a weak local uniformization, I will have this, and also tensoring with any shift on Y. And I think that one can do it also uniformly in I, even when the dimension is unbounded, using the technique of expose S13 in the asterisk book. And so now. So I want to, first I use structure of constructible sheaves to reduce to a case where I have, I have to also to evaluate it on some object, but suppose I already know that the object on which I evaluate is comes from an open in X minus Y. But of course this requires to make some, but then the sheaf is again, a tensor product, but you can assume the shift is like an extension by zero of something locally constant on some, and then by passing to a finite cover, I say extension by zero of a constant, and then constant. So I, but then I want to make it a situation nice to use the calculation in the log regular case. So I need a covering for the H topology, like I use in the finiteness theorems, to do this. And of course, I need all the cohomological descent thing that goes into that, and the similar thing for the rigid cohomology. But it's.
So, do you need an oriented cohomological descent or not?
Well, there are. So here. Since I, it looks like formally I need, since I replace by, it looks like yes. So now when, by the way, so when the same situation. In the non, there are failures in the when you are in the non-Noetherian, non-quasi-excellent case. For example, it is easy to see that for valuation ring of rank two, this should fail. So because you have situation where the rigid, simply you have two points, somehow when you look rigid analytically or complete along that, you don't see the generic points. So you can see that this comparison between cohomology of omega and omega ridge will. The omega could be not could be a generic point of for a rank two evaluation ring, and this would be empty. So this cannot hold. But on the other hand, for if you work over rank one evaluation rings and the same even non-Noetherian, then one can reduce to let's say those with algebraically closed field of fraction, and then one can have an analog of the weak local uniformization in terms of. Log smooth saturated morphisms, and one can generalize this approach, and also over one dimensional Noetherian scheme. So one can have a generic version over an open, let's say, and then you at finitely many points you can compare to the completion or to the normalization you have. So the quasi-excellent is not so important for one-dimensional DVR because you and when you have Noetherian, so in the case of Nagata's example of normal, non-analytically normal things, so one can see that it gives a situation where this fails in the dimension two Nagata type example of non-analytically normal. You will have a situation where when you do some completion, so before when you do completion along Y, the analytic, the algebraic etal cohomology will change, so it cannot, and after completion it will be quasi excellent, so you will not have a comparison to, in the general Noetherian case. I'm sorry. I tried to read some assorted sketchy notes, but I was. So anyway, there are more results about like questions of Orgogozo and. But this was the. Okay. So there are questions about. But this is not related to this. I mean, like which blowing up you need to make the vanishing cycle nice. But. What?
You have few minutes to discuss if you want.
When did I start?
You have
Ah, no, no, okay. I thought that I am...
No, you're 17.
Okay. So... So in any case, the example that I mentioned in the end about the non... when you have let's say I is a DVR and I have something in the completion which is transcendental over I, then one can construct in the you can add that to I, yeah, so you can consider things like y minus phi to the n minus some approximation divided by pow. So uniform is of the uniformizer. So you have some extension of the local ring. So the idea is that it will be isomorphism on the completion, even the pi-adic completion, and you will have so you will have something which is irreducible. You will have a regular local ring and an irreducible thing which in the completion becomes an nth power, and you can even make it strictly n-zillion. And so this, and then when you take an nth root, you get this, so let's say n prime to p, So this is an example of Nagata also discussed in the asterisk book. And so here I will take omega to be the complement of z. So I can also complete along z without changing the properties. And so I will have a situation where also I strictly analyze. So when I complete, okay, so when I so now over, so when you complete along the special fiber, the since already z complete, this is like completing the local ring, so then this will be this will have n components, so omega will have n components. And so in any case, I have a situation where just when I do the direct image of the constant shift in the original situation is z mod l, and let's say in the completed along special fiber situation z mod l to the n. And after I do this completion, I'm in the quasi excellent case, so I have a comparison with the rigid analytic. So the rigid analytic space will not change, so this shows the comparison phase. Let me maybe about this twist by things coming from the base is like this. So I have some rigid analytic space. Some tubular neighborhood maybe to Y. So I have some quasi-compact and quasi-separated map. And then I claim that this is a general fact. So I claim that Ri Flow star for all shifts in the analytic adic space commutes with tensor products with a shift on Y. So this must be, this is related to statements of Bayesian theorems of Huber, but I didn't find it exactly in his book, but it is. So this comes from the universal Bayes change phenomenon that I explained, because I hope it's, so let's see. So no. No, I this no, excuse me. So I have I need to introduce the Zariski Riemann space here, though it will be the map, the direct image to this Zariski Riemann space can be computed using Galois cohomologies locally at Stock. So I need this monodromic shift argument, because I have a situation which is non-proper, but I control the non-properness using the monodromic shift over DS. So then, in all the cases, when I compute, I get monodromic shift, so I can restrict the zero section. This is used also for twists by constant shifts and by arbitrary shifts on the base. So I think so. This is not. Okay.
Any questions?
Of course, but maybe other people.
So you said monodromic shifts. This is the Verdier story.
Yeah, so Verdier, at least in a finite type situation over a field, but one can generalize over more bases. And also here it's not exactly finite type, because it's possibly an inverse. Well, in any blow-up, yeah, I work in a. Yeah, so you have a kind of a con situation or a speck of a graded algebra.
I thought that your business with the phi n. Or something like reduction to normal cone. Some analog of that.
Yeah, so in any case, I have a situation where I want to understand this rigid analytic thing. So I have something defined by F equals zero. This is defined by phi equals zero. I want to understand this by blowing up. And after I blow up, I can. What was the question?
Oh, it's similar to reduction to normal cone somehow. That reduction to monodromic sheaves, but I'm not sure.
No, in Verdier there is this normal cone. I mean, he uses it for his specialization of sheaves. But here, what happens is that when I do it at least with n large enough, the point is that f. I want to exclude cases where f, like f could be locally phi to the n times a non-zero constant, I mean, times a unit, and this I don't want. So, so there is a. There are points which are in the closure of f equals zero outside y, and the other point. So at those points, I get just the zero section, at least in the reduced local. At those points, I get the full A1. But after I normalize, I get possibly another A1, but some up to isogeny GM still acts on this one. So I can see that, of course, this requires a commutative algebra. At least when I take the reduced locus, I have an action of GM up to some isogeny on the reduced local of the normalized blow-up. And since I can calculate the stocks using logarithmic geometry, you get something which is constant, or essentially on the orbits. So you get the monodromic shift, and then
you use very thin actions, or not in this business?
I just need this kind of hypercover and cohomological descent for both the rigid and the oriented product situation to reduce to nice situations. So I very time appears in the proofs, but not in the.
So this is an instance where oriented cohomological descent really enters, because in the book eventually you can get rid of it.
Yeah, there was an appendix of Sheng that you could do it with. Yeah.
Here the appendix is no.
Yeah, in fact, the appendix of Zheng is like the argument I had in mind, which was when I lectured in Princeton, it was something like what it did, I mean, like to look at the structure of the proof of the structure of the argument cohomological descent, still it gives what one needs, but then it turned into a oriented cohomological descent in the seminar, but the original idea was like what Zheng did in this. And which also works in the complex case without having oriented, without having a theory of oriented products in that case.
So the last question is somehow philosophical. What kind of applications of this main theorem that to the effect that F is R epsilon one star of epsilon upper star of F? Does it simplify proofs in analytic rigid analytic geometry, or does it simply?
No, this includes. So the main point here is to prove a comparison between algebraic and analytic cohomology, and this is like a comparison, and it is proved in the expected way by kind of the resolution singularity. If you have enough resolution singularity, reduced to nice calculations, so it's. It cannot, but then I thought about more refined, so the thing I talked in Tokyo in 2018 was also things about like the properties of vanishing cycle, like the
so maybe we put it for Luke's 90th birthday.
No, maybe I will. I will talk in the next online conference for Takeshi. I will I will continue about the other topics. So in particular, I can prove. I think, and in any case, so if on an open you have, I can also do a truncated version. So if the vanishing cycle of a general basis up to some degree are well behaved on an open, then it's enough to blow up something in the complement. So this is a question of Fujiwara to get.
Yes.
Okay. And also you have the local situation. So in the case where there is a good theory, I can prove that the map of balls is cohomologically proper. So Nogozo has another proof for this using another possible modification, but I can prove that the goodness already implies cohomological properness for minor balls. And also there is a question of the Japanese on good and very good. It's transitivity and a transit.
Yes, so as Ahmed said, for my next
For Takeshi first,
birthday.
So Let's Takeshi keep this in mind for Takeshi's.
Okay.
Okay, that's a fact for Professor Gabber for his talk, okay.